Kia ora, rongo mai. Kia ora, rongo mai. A really great honour to come and talk to you on behalf of the waka, on behalf of my iwi Ngāti Rangitihi, to my whānau that are here, ngā mihi, and thank you for coming to talk. I'm really one for more casual conversations. They make it less stressful for me, really. So being the very first public talk about the waka, I want in part to be really led by you who have just come to befriend him. And there may be things that you wish to know about him that hasn't yet surfaced, because he is only in a week. He is only a week and a half old, although he's been 2 years in the making. So in that that state of us being relaxed and being here together, please feel free to raise your hand. I can repeat your question so that everybody can hear it. And I really hope you can feed the talk by adding to it. So I'm going to kick it off, at least. Guide Kaiārahi is in its first instance inspired by the phantom waka, the apparition that appeared 11 days before the eruption of Tarawera, at the same time as a typhoid outbreak in the Tarawera Te Arawa region. And just as a show of hands, since there's so many people here at once, who would stand by the belief that the apparition was a esoteric phenomenon, that it was a spiritual phenomenon? Can I just see a raise of hands? And who, on the other hand, would think it was could be scientifically explained as an environmental and optical phenomenon? Can you raise your hands? Oh wow, we've got like a spiritually rich audience. I like that very much. At both points, does the work try to identify the spiritual and the scientific? And the scientific explanation for the apparition of the phantom waka has been described in the optical phenomenon, the Brocken spectre. At this time, there were gases and surges in the tide of Lake Tarawera, which were said to enhance the throw of a low-lying sun to project the shadow of a waka onto a mist, a water's mist. For Te Arawa, we of course see that as the ominous premonition of the disaster that occurred, and it is a disaster very familiar to all of our histories, but particularly in this history, I wanted to be able to also highlight that Ngāti Rangitihi were displaced from the shadow of Tarawera to where we now live, which is the coast of Matata in the Bay of Plenty. It's a really significant moment to consider this for us also, as the day after the opening of Toi Tū Toi Ora, which just closed here at the Auckland Art Gallery, curated by Nigel Burrell. Ngāti Rangitihi signed the settlement deed with the Crown. So we now have, after many years of displacement because of the Tarawera, a place to call home. It's a place where my father grew up, and I feel very close to, although my father was a part of the migrations that led us to Auckland, and I now call Auckland my home. On any of that, does anybody have something they'd like to ask? I got a question, yes. Hello, sir. Hi, Robert. Yes. The waka in its entirety was actually made in Brisbane, It wasn't made here in New Zealand. And I know that that, in part, is going to make some gasp in the expectation that a waka should be made in New Zealand. But practically, we had a very short time frame. This waka has been a two-year project in overall, and 2 years isn't a long period of time for such a major public artwork. I worked very closely with UAP, they're called Urban Art Projects in Brisbane, and came with my own set of nerves in that I was wanting to talk about things philosophically Māori and deeply connected to my whakapapa with Australians. And I wasn't really sure how we may have been able to connect not only through material, but through all of the decorative visualizations that are a major component of the tōihu that sits at the top and the tōrapa that sits at the bottom. But there was complete success. Through those 2 years, we operated very deeply and very true to the concept of the artwork, which is the apparition of the phantom waka. In that, we both worked as apparitions through technology between Aotearoa and New Zealand. I always look for these affirmations, the signs, and when our bubbles did finally open, I was lucky enough to make it over to Brisbane to finally meet my waka. And this is why I call him a he. He carries the pronoun he because that is the Māori that I felt immediately on my physical introduction with him. You may have noticed if you've tried to take photographs of him, he almost appears invisible. And he's very hard to capture, just like a phantom waka may be, unless you're trying to do this in the evening when his navigational star system comes out and appears on the walls and ceilings of the Auckland Art Gallery. That feeling of knowing he was male made a nice connection for me to the idea that he still had an intrinsic whakapapa to the natural world. He wasn't a part of a myth and a legend as such, but still carries the traditions of waka making with him. He was sort of revealed to me, I was like not allowed to see him, I was spun around. And the first thing I saw was that there were a whole lot of men standing around him, protecting him. And then I felt him. I lost my train of thought. Anyway. There's another question. Great, thank you. The question was, if he was to return to Lake Tarawera, would I prefer to see him on the water, under the water, or overlooking the water, or around the water? I think that he is a sculpture. He isn't a waka, but he takes his inspiration from the waka's form. And I've tried to connect him to those traditions through the materiality of the waka, and I will answer that question. I just want to ramble a little bit. Without going into too much of the science of the materiality of the waka, the plexiglass component has the same gravity as water. So at the same time, the waka is the water. But there is also this history of connecting the waka to water through the crystal and the glass. And we all know that glass comes from sand. So he makes his connection back to the shore and to his journey of navigation and to the gods of tangaroa, of water. What I really like about this work, and why I'd probably want him to sit at the shore of Lake Tarawera, is that when you look through it, you are given a multifaceted view of the world. And it isn't one singular way of looking at something, but it's almost a, could I describe it as a multi-dimensional way of being able to look at the lake and look at the land. And that multi-dimensional, that multifaceted viewpoint intrigues me as a person of mixed race. It also allows us to, I think, more fluidly take on the views of others. And to carry that through into the work, all of the figures that you find in the waka, in the taurapa and the tauihu, have faceted crystals in their eyes. So a part of the tradition of waka making is that once the paua is placed into the eyes, that figure then can now see. They have the sight of which to navigate and travel and traverse. So by placing the crystals in the waka, I've allowed him to see, but I want him to see the same way that crystals do. I want him to see in a very multifaceted way, a multi-dimensional way, and I want the work to see as many viewpoints as possible. So I think that's how I would like to see him viewed. And you know, if you go and have a look at the waka again after this, there is these opportunities for you to look through and see this other world, to experience the world in facets and see it in another way. It was a work that could not be completed any earlier than today. The plexiglass, which is really the structure of this waka, 5 years ago wouldn't have been able to be manipulated this way, which I think could be fascinating to people who work with plastics. But he also offers some very intriguing interests for welders. I don't know if we've got any welders in the house, but the stainless steel frame has been done so beautifully because it has neither warped nor bent for such a delicate structure. So I think he offers a lot of admiration across many cultures and even trades, which I think is very nice and inclusive.
Kia ora.
Kia ora.
From a design perspective, can you talk about your choice as an artist to have the waka vertical versus horizontal?
Yes. Thank you. Did everybody hear that question? Why is the waka vertical rather than horizontal? I think in the first instance, it was to beat expectation, because I know that that there would have been, it would have been expected for him to be in that position, to be in the unknown, but an artwork's job is to turn that on its head and present something to you that was completely unexpected. But he also, he is also in the vertical position for a lot of other reasons, and I'll give you a few. These three po behind me are carved by Arnold Manaaki Wilson, who I've just found out is whānau to Ngāti Rangitihi, which is very cool. He was very well regarded and very well respected as a champion and a leader of contemporary Māori art practice, particularly during the 50s, with the advent of contemporary Māori art. And my waka sets to act as the fourth po to Arnold's third, to Arnold's three. I also wanted him to be in a vertical to act as a compass needle to direct us upward, into, and onward. When he is in the vertical, the seating braces become a ladder. So we can make connections to very pictorial metaphors about the ascension, art history to heaven and how to get there. And I only believe that we're all performing together to go onward and upward. There is no down in my world. The up is also a reference to what could be considered north. He also, in his vertical position, talks to the tradition of waka being made out of wood and the whakapapa of wood to tāne mahuta. And on that idea, we all know the story of tāne separating rangi and papa. And when he did so, when this first hara happened, the hara, the misdeed, is balanced out by great good for humanity. And with the coming of the light came three gifts: mātauranga, knowledge; whakapapa, genealogy; and tikanga, protocols. And this work can't help but exercise the right to think about these, this whakapapa, this lineage to tāne, because he operates in light. He is acknowledged in light, seen in light, possessed by light, and truly beautiful, made beautiful by light. The inspirations for the decorative elements came from two pieces at the Te Papa collection that had no provenance. And I was very taken by the idea that something at Te Papa in their collection that was a Māori taonga had no provenance. It strikes me as quite bizarre. And I did want to give some provenance back to these pieces to reclaim their history so that they are now and forever connected to this artwork. And when I went to meet these pieces, I went into a room that's underneath Te Papa that houses all Māori taonga, and it is one of the most exceptional rooms I've ever had the experience of being in. And it took us a little while to find these two pieces. I was looking for really majestic, very large waka pieces that ended up being very small. The tauihu was only about this big, and I picked them up. Gave him a hongi, and then carried him around like a little shih tzu, looking at all the other decorative pieces in the collection of Te Papa. I feel like I made a friend and explained what I was doing to him. And then the same thing happened with the tauapa, the end piece. He too was very small, so he became the, a miniature poodle that I took around under my arm, meeting the rest of the taonga in the room. It's These pieces that were in Te Papa were so small because they're used as educational tools. They themselves aren't the taonga, but they're tools in which carvers could learn the detailing, learn design, learn meaning to impart on those bigger pieces. And I liked too that in the layers of the work, the education component connects so clearly to the idea of being guided, of relearning or learning something bigger. And as the waka was an omen on Lake Tarawera, I quite like to shift the meaning of what omen may mean so that we are maybe less fearless of being guided to the unexpected. I used to be a primary school teacher, and it was an incredible 2 years, and I was a teacher at Westmead Primary School, and it was something that has informed even my art practice. I think that being able to take the stage in a classroom makes it a little easier for me to take a stage at the gallery in front of so many people. And I like that there are these learning and education components to it. The idea of guide being educational is also connected to Te Paia Henerangi, or Guide Sophia, her name Guide Sophia, as a guide on Lake Tarawera for tourists who were visiting the eighth wonder of our world, the pink and white terraces, and how she was guiding people through not only, I guess, some kaupapa Māori of the place, but also the introduction she made to the new future people were experiencing on the lake. If you don't know my practice, it really began as a gift from my father, I will say that. He passed away 20 years ago, and it was his 70th birthday yesterday, wasn't it, Auntie? He turned 70 yesterday, and I had this desire to do a cool whai painting for him. And the painting is the same height of him standing, but also the same length of him in wake. That was a very personal testament I put to the work. And it was a way of celebrating him rather than expressing the deep sorrow of loss. And so glitter as a material started off in a very different way for me. And I have been an artist for over 20 years now, and I have made it my fight to try to exercise the right of glitter to be more than the sum of its parts, which we all know as being very related to craft. It's the school holidays, the kids go crazy in it, to carnival and to drag, to allow the material to have a greater voice than just those sums of those parts. And I think moving into prisms has allowed the material to grow up a little bit. It's like if it was 21, the glitter would be doing a yardie somewhere at some gallery in Auckland. But the prisms allowed me for the first time to get the idea of reflection and refraction out into the public. And I have tried this, but it just doesn't work. It's not meant to be outdoors. It's too fragile. So I think it was a very logical step to move into maybe pieces of glitter that are quite enlarged and overfaceted that still do the same thing. And in doing so, I've become very interested in the evolutionary theory of why we are attracted to things that sparkle. Now, in this evolutionary theory, if we look at why as a species we are attracted to shiny things, what is that for? Why is that? Why do we like rings? Why do we like shiny, glittering things? And evolutionary theory explains it as that we have an innate DNA supported need to survive, and we all know that. And there's one thing that we need to survive with, and that is water. So as humans, when we see water, it sparkles, and by sparkling it attracts our attention, and we draw near and we survive. So it's I've been very interested in those layers and those concepts of why the material will always be more than those sums of its parts. It looked amazing in the rain, maybe just almost becoming invisible. But I guess he's connecting to this lineage I've created of water to him. The water underneath it. It is a really beautiful thing because I very much like the idea of narcissus, that something looks at itself, and I think the waka is doing that too in the reflection of this pond. You can see the entirety of him in the blackness of that pool, although it's only 10 centimetres deep. Oh, you can see the narcissus of him in the reflection of this glass, which makes, I think, a complete connect in the idea of sands, navigation, and shore through contemporary time. Thank you, too. Was it? Hi. Hello.
Kia ora.
You're welcome.
I would like to ask, is there a reason why you chose plexiglass instead of glass to create your work? Apart from, I guess, money would be the main reason.
Main reason.
Okay.
Yeah.
Glass and hard, that's one.
Oh.
And I recognize a few others.
Amazing. May I ask you a question? Thank you. Did you interpret when you first saw the plexiglass as glass, as a glass artist?
No.
Okay.
But that is just my art.
Right? Yes.
There's nothing else than that.
Yeah. You have a relationship with a material.
Yes.
And your friendship means you know a lot about how glass performs and looks. But I did believe that the plexiglass would maybe look even more plastic. But for me, without like an untrained eye like you, without a trained eye like yours, I read it very much as glass, but I think there's a psychology of preciousness that comes into play, where you see crystal, and you see sparkle, and you think value, and then you think wealth, so you think glass. It can't be plastic, but it was just down to finance, most definitely. This work, and that's a great segue for me to say, the Edmiston Trust is the funder for this project. And it was commissioned by the Auckland City Art Gallery, but it had another iteration completely. So 6 years ago, just before I moved to live in New Plymouth, I was invited to do a proposal for a work in this reflection pool. And it was a giant upside down rose, and it was called If Love Was a Weapon. And it was about 3 years through that project that Rana Davenport, who was then director of the gallery, left to work in Australia. And Kirsten Paisley came to become the new director of Auckland Art Gallery, and the chair of the Edmiston changed to Lady Dale Mace, that they asked me to redo it, and by God, I'm glad they did. I was living in New Plymouth when I proposed this work and moved back to Auckland just as the work was going up. So it's been a lovely cycle for me over 6 years of the first idea to final iteration, of leaving and being pulled home again by my crystal waka. I think I heard a little bit of it, but all I'm going to say is thank you for having such a great scientific mind. But don't forget, it's still an artwork. It's not trying to, I don't want people to believe that it can perform. He only has one job. I've given him one job, and that's to be the voice of an artwork to you. But I tell you what, I really love what people bring, because I guess my views and my ideas are capped. My brain can only go so far, and I love how much further you're able to take me. So thank you. On that, I want to introduce a really, on this idea of being introduced to other ideas, I want to talk about being introduced to an idea that sort of blew my mind a little bit. Because you don't know what the waka really wants to say to you until you tell, or I don't know what it wants to say to you until you tell me. But a gentleman came to me after I'd done a little talk about it, and I loved that he just put it all on the table. He said to me, I don't know whether I've seen a UFO or not. And I'm like, well, I don't know either. He's like, you know, when I was a little boy, I saw these lights, and ever since that day, have not been able to figure out what it was, but I believe they weren't of this world. And I just thought that that was so humbling, first off, to get honesty like that, when judgment can be so crippling, but that he was reminded of that as I talked about what the experience of the lights that surround this work could be. At the core, they are always going to be the waka's way to navigate forward. The waka has created his own constellation. But I really enjoy that this work throws rainbows. And as a gay man, I'm really over the rainbow flag in the city, really over it. So if you're over something, you have to do something about it. So that's what I've done about it. The best spectrum you'll ever see. Yes.
The question before the last question about being a glass person as opposed to a perspex person.
Yes.
Is there a light refraction difference?
Yes. She nods yes. There is a different light refraction. Would you be able to explain the differences between the light refraction of plastic and glass? I know Swarovski glass to have a lead content, and it's that content of lead that gives you clarity, but also the clarity of the orb or the rainbow that goes through it onto the other side. I have worked with a prism artist, his name is Walter Foote, who's based in Taranaki on a prism project in Manukau City. And he used a two-pot resin to make prisms that throw some phenomenal rainbows. But I guess what I'm hearing is, if it's glass though, the clarity of glass and the lead content can make it bigger, stronger, bolder, like that. Yeah. But you still see those distortions of him when the light, because the light can still get through plexiglass, but not with the clarity of glass.
Although it's got steel in it.
Maybe not. Yes. The steel also adds to the refraction of light when you get that that silhouette or that mysterious esoteric shadow, that shadowing that so talks to the Brocken Spectre or to the apparition. And in the original idea, the waka was to be floating. I wanted him to float and not be connected to the land in any way. Yet we could not engineer that. It was impossible. So the stainless steel is a way to create the invisible, or in that the stainless reflects the environment, maybe as if the environment isn't there. And I think it's really succeeded in doing that and becoming another secret, another bit of magic, another bit of maybe unexplainable. Thank you. I'm just really, I never would have guessed that people could connect to a work like this. I don't know, I guess I'm too... One thing I guess I should explain is that for artists, because we've been so heavily involved in it, we're not seeing something ever for the first time. And that's, I think, the process of giving things away is easier for us because we know it so well, internally and externally. And so I didn't want to assume how people would react to him. But one thing that I've been really taken by, apart from the UFO story, was friends who have felt emotional, and I hope I can express this correctly, They felt emotional at seeing a nationalism in themselves that they'd never been able to identify with before. Does that sort of make sense? That they had seen in themselves what nationalism is in that work. I think it's Māori, but it isn't from me. I don't think it's from me, I think it's his. And that's why I can give him the pronoun, because he is doing something. He's performing like, you know, with the abilities of a person. But I have to say, you know, this is nothing to do with me. This is a Te Arawa story. You know, this comes through my father, and it talks to a much bigger picture than that. And I hold fast to that, you know. Hello, fellow artist.
No, I missed how long it took to make. Was it Palmerston North, New Plymouth, sorry. And the other thing is, any beautiful structure that humans seem to like, for example, the Eiffel Tower, was there anybody hurt in the construction? Because there's beauty in
pain.
Giving your life towards something, but there's in beauty, there's sometimes pain. Thank you.
Was the question, was anybody hurt?
How long did it take to make?
Yep.
Where was it made?
Yep.
And was there any hurt in it that, like, people died making the Eiffel Tower or whatever? Like, did you look well? You've got both arms. Did you cut yourself? Or thank you.
Thank you. It's a beautiful polarity, isn't it? Pain and whatever else sits with it, yeah, or beauty. I was actually, when you said pain, I was trying to think of a different type of pain. Not that I know of. I was trying to think past physical. The work comes with pain because it's a story of a disaster that was at the same time as a typhoid epidemic. You know, there was a lot of pain in that history. There was pain in the displacement of Ngāti Rangitihi from Tarawera. But the beauty, as I said before, there has been a beauty in the signing of the treaty settlement. You know, everything comes around, doesn't it? Yeah, sorry, I can't think of anything else. It was, I think we're in a world of, safety is such a huge issue. Like, it would, you know, you just can't move without having to get somebody to sign the bit of paper. There was nothing that was hurt. I think it was the complete opposite. Yeah. Thank you for your question, though. Hi.
Kia ora. When you went to Brisbane, that was the first time that you'd... When you went to Brisbane, that was the first time that you'd actually seen the waka, mm-hmm. Right?
Yes.
So how did you actually feel? What did you think when you walked in there? Was that like us walking... Almost like walking around the corner and seeing it.
I guess yeah. I did get to see a first time.
Yeah.
Although I said to you that we don't often. I guess I did. Chelsea Winstanley in the house is doing a doco on Toi Tū, Toi Ora, and was there in Brisbane and can attest to the tears. I thought I was going on a very practical material and engineering-based trip that, as I told you when I spun around, it was tears. But they were, you know, those ancestral tears you have? It was like that for 2 days. For 2 days, yeah. It was beautiful. It was lovely to to be able to express them. And they didn't actually stop. It started again when the waka came over. But he is a part of a story. And I think that's why I wanted to talk with you today, with your questions. When he was going to arrive in June, and he was, the day we found out he wasn't, because the waka missed the waka in Brisbane, go figure that. It was actually the 135th anniversary of the Tarawera eruption. And I just thought, yeah, of course. The waka didn't make it because he had to be disrupted by the history of that eruption. This is what this work has become to me in this short period. They've become interconnected because they are the story, but they're interconnected through their truths, that anniversary did disrupt his arrival. Yet also when he was going to be installed, the weather was so bad we wouldn't have been able to do it. It's like not only did COVID upset that transportation process, but I think that COVID has been really great for me personally in just letting things go a little bit more. I've been a teacher, and that's tick control freak, and I run my own studio, tick control freak. I think for me, and I think a lot of people will experience this, it just lets you let things go a little bit more and be a part of whatever. It's all going to be good.
Can I just change the subject a little? The reason that your waka is standing there is because of this man next to me, Willie.
Really? Not a Willie?
Kia ora.
Kia ora.
I get a beautiful vibration from your work out there.
Thank you.
And I wanted to say, outlive my visualizations of, I just heard, there's going to be a waka placed here, and I worked on the anchor, the foundation for it.
Lovely to meet you here, Willie.
It's beautiful, nice piece of work. I also worked on Chris Booth's waka and wave up in Whangarei years ago.
Okay.
And he parked that one up on the rivers.
Yes.
Yeah. So when I saw that, I was like, whoa. It's
going.
I look forward to seeing the sun on it.
Kia ora, Willie, thank you.
Thank you.
The credits to the making of this work runs like a movie script. And everybody is so valuable in making it work. The gallery was very kind to me, and they didn't get me in all the time to meet all of the valuable people who made this work come to life. So it's really lovely to meet you, Willie. You had a huge job. The pool hadn't been engineered for weight when this new apparition was designed for the gallery. Excuse me. Ralph Hortere was commissioned to create a permanent work for the reflection pool, but in his passing, his drawings weren't developed further enough for it to be made from the idea. So the pool is now going to forever be a site for sculpture. And this, along with being the first more permanent sculpture, because there have been two in here before, one by Filipe Tohi and another artist whose name I can't remember, it meant that everything that you can't see had to be done for the first time. So Willie has done some serious magic, engineering right through the footplate of the paipai, into the storage room below, yet still letting that perform like a reflection pool with water. There's like still water in there, which is magic when we've all been affected by drips and
kia ora.
What's the weight of that?
The weight, I understand the weight to be less than 1 tonne, but I don't know what that is. What is it? I don't know what that is. Yeah. What is the, oh yes, hi. Hello. Kia ora. When you say that, and I love how you talk to me, because I like to talk like this. I really like this question because I like the way you're talking to me. So maybe I can answer like this. This is the, huh? No, I can hear, I heard you. Did everybody hear it? I guess for me, what I heard you say is, truthfully, from your heart, how much of the story resonates for you in the work? I love it. I love that question. I sure bloody do. I love it. I love it. I mean, just as you're talking, I just have these floods of feelings and of thoughts. You used a word, resonates, and resonates is what I'm just going to kick off from here. My father forever resonates within me. My father as a brother resonates within me when I look at my auntie's face. The resonation isn't a singular meaning. It's these works to me allow these people who have gone to come through more easily. Does that make sense when I say that? When a person isn't defined by their body or a photo, I feel that I have easier access to my father and to my iwi and to my family and to my whakapapa and to my history. So these objects are the open door for me to connect to them. I was born in Auckland, but am not far from my identity on both my mother's side and on my father's side. The kōwhaiwhai I painted, that I started painting outside of art school 20 years ago, that was actually the first lot of work I made, because I want to talk about kōwhaiwhai and my connection to kōwhaiwhai in a heartfelt way. Was when my dad passed, 3 months before he passed, I lived in the UK and I really wanted to stay there, but I couldn't, so I came home and I had 3 months with him. And in honesty, I didn't really get along well with my dad as a gay man, but as soon as I came back from finding my securities overseas within myself, our relationship really blossomed beautifully. So 3 months was better than nothing. And on his passing, I wanted to mihi him through kōwhaiwhai and four panels, 1, 2, 3, 4, to celebrate his life and to introduce him to the world in celebration. So the outset of the kōwhaiwhai was really what I call a gift from him, because it was about him. And that work that I called the wharenui that Dad built, based on Gavin Bishop's remaking the house that Jack built, propelled my whole career. I have a family member quite high up in the police. He's offered to do patrols. I think I've done some work out in public before, and I can see some artists who are here now who do work outside too. So maybe they want to talk about that as well. But I just believe that if you can make a work that people connect with, and through the connection form an ownership, the work will be forever safe and it can be saved by others. If they've just got that connection to it, if they feel connected to it. You know, this is in town and so it is a vulnerable place, but I don't know, it's, I guess if it happens, it happens. Everything can be fixed. And that's, maybe that's how I get by with the idea that everything can be fixed. No, I mean, I think I had a lot of anxiety leading up to the work going up, and I had really deep paternal control issues around everything to do with him, and going through the blessing and having the opening really, and that whole week really let him free. So I feel like this too is another exercise in letting the work free to do his work, and then I can go and do some more. But yeah, I think you guys have to keep him safe, I think. Yeah, that's an awesome question. Charlotte is an amazing artist. And if you didn't hear a question, she said, Charlotte said, were there any spiritual experiences during the work's making, and how was it navigated? Man. There was a lot. Once I sort of, I started actually listing them all. So I have a few pages of what I have called the spiritual experiences of the work. First off, I think too, when you're working with tikanga and tradition, you're going to be navigating tapu and noa, right? So I have a little bit of a fearlessness around tapu. Oh, I said that on stage. That is like, whoa. Because I intrinsically believe that I'm being looked after. And I truly believe that none of my tūpuna wish any bad upon me. And with that thought, I feel I can navigate through things and for those things to be looked after by them. Because I don't necessarily know how to do that. One of the first things I think that was the awakening that these things were happening was in Brisbane when I went to see the work, and I turned around and all of the men were around him protecting him, and I had the sense that although I didn't have the knowledge to participate in the tikanga, that the tikanga was being performed for me in order that this work be made. That was sort of like the first instance. The other spiritual experience for me was one I've talked about, where the waka missing the waka happened on the 135th anniversary of the eruption of Tarawera. That to me was the signifier that the work had Māori and was connecting to the anniversary of the mountain. He was alive. He had spirit. Off the top of my head, I'm just trying to think, because it was synergetically endless, the esoteric happenstance. Oh, I've got a great one, Charlotte. Okay. Right, for all of you atheists out there, this is for you. We had a really special blessing with Ngāti Whātua. Excuse me, on a week gone Thursday. And it was a dawn blessing. And I didn't want the blessing to be too heavy. I wanted to keep it very light because I wanted the work to have the lightness to go forth and do his mahi. And on that, I got the children from Westmead Primary School, where I used to teach, from the bilingual unit, to waiata the lightness of the work. And so, the blessing was for 7 a.m. And I arrived at 6, because a friend was early. And I came down Kitchener Street, and the lights went on, that light that are in the pool that light up the toad upper. And I was like, oh, well, damn. And then I thought, oh, well, maybe these lights will come on when the right person comes. Surely the work is just waiting for the right person, and then they'll come on. So during that time, in the meantime, there was a bit of a flurry. An electrician could not figure out what had happened. There was no rhyme or reason for those lights to be off. And so I just let that go, and it's like, it's all good. It is what it is. There was just the most amazing blessing from Ngāti Whātua. And one of your whanaunga, Sharon, blew on the conch, and at exactly the moment the sound came out, the lights came on. Like, exactly, and it wasn't timed, so that the atheist next to me says, an atheist walks into a bar and says, he was like, oh, that was so beautifully timed. And it's like, dude, it wasn't. And then just above you too, Charlotte, we all came in here, and these lights up here were just flicking. Just like, all morning until we finished, and then they were like this, just back to normal. But it, you know, it didn't go unnoticed, and it was, I'm totally comfortable with that. How could it not? But this gangway here, I don't want to freak you out up there on the gangway. There's an artist called Nathan Porhio who had a work on the paepae out here for the last Gordon Walters Art Prize. And it was a light box out here. And at night time, the security guard saw a figure walking here. So clearly that the security guard said, hey, what are you doing in here? And so this is a very interesting spot. I don't know why. And it's a good spot. It's not like a bad thing. You're all looked after, I promise you. So that, I think, was one of the most connectable moments. I think it was Auntie Kathy. I do, because she was so naughty. But yeah, that was, I think, one of the more beautiful ones, beautiful experiences that happened. I just think we're going to start seeing that a lot more when everything's right. So in a way, I think I could be a conduit for creating work. Maybe we're just all conduits. But that was very special. And I liked that it was about light. Because, you know, in art history and how I've spoken about light today, it is the best, it is the way we have exampled the spirit world. We use it in art history for the Holy Trinity, the coming of God, the light of God. And I'm not trying to perform anything specifically denominational in saying that, but I like that light, it was the lights that played. It was the purity of spirit that played. Very cool to have platforms to talk about things like this.
Do you think that the Phantom Waka will start featuring in some more indoor pieces, like either sculpture or artworks, or is he going to just be a standalone piece and telling his own story?
I think he will. I think when I decided I could be a sculptor, I realised there was a whole new world out there for me. Back in art school at Elam, I didn't think I had the capacity to see things very well in three dimensions, and my car is proof of that. The rims are totally screwed. So when I understood that I did see it, but I just saw it differently to how I thought I did, sculpture has become a whole new world for me, as is art. Art is its own life. I just share the company of it. So I definitely do want to make more sculptures, and this work has been the platform to allow me to do that. I think it's always been in the painting, because glitter was the childlike form of this adult version. But a lot of that is, I guess, unknowns too. Thank you, everybody. I have spoken enough.
Kia ora. One more question.
Where are you?
Kia ora, Reuben.
I can't even see you. Oh, Natalie.
Kia ora. Namahinu kia koe. When you said that the lights flickered and the pool remained dark, I thought immediately of Ralph Hortiri and his collaboration with Bill Colbert, and your waka being the upright light to the pathway
of Aramoana.
Of Aramoana for Ralph's work, and I wonder perhaps if you'd thought about that, whether perhaps Ralph may have turned the lights on.
That's so true. Was he a naughty guy? I never met him.
Humorous and mischievous.
Ah.
And I wondered whether you had thought about that relationship just with this, his collaborations, and whether you talked about his drawings not being quite complete.
Yes.
So I just wanted to ask if that came into your whakaaro, kia ora.
Maybe just respectfully, because he is one of many of my favourite artists that I didn't get a chance to meet, so I have met him through his work. But I think that work you talked about, Pathway to Aramoana, is one of my favourite pieces in collaboration between Bill Colbert and Ralph Hortiri. And of course, Bill Colbert is exhibiting now somewhere up there. And the Pathway to Aramoana was Bill Colbert as a really long line of fluorescent lights, and as mirror, Ralph's was a long line of power with the line revealed in the colours of abalone through the mollusked skin. So two pathways, Pākehā one and a Māori one. Black corrugated one. Ah, that's nice, because that pool is so black and then the waka is so fluorescent. I hadn't, but I really love that you see that. Natalie has a show on at St. Paul Street at the moment, just props to that.
Thank you again to Reuben.
Thank you. Thank you.